Greetings, everyone, and welcome. I'm the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone. You tune in to another edition of Soul Facts, a show highlighting the history and music of legendary artists and preserving their legacies. And this edition features one of the most versatile, multi-talented, gifted artists to emerge from the genesis of the Motown era from the early 1960s throughout the 1980s. Soul Facts Spotlight artist, Miss Kim Weston. Born December 20th, 1939 in Detroit, Michigan, Agatha Natalia Weston, known to the music world as Kim Weston, began singing at the age of three at a local church called the AOH, Apostolic Overcoming Holy Church of God. Kim asked her mother if she could sing solo in the church. With permission from her mother, she sang Journey to the Sky and loved it. As a child, she attended Brownstown Elementary School in Detroit. After Weston graduated from Miller High School, she was recruited by a gospel group called the Christianaires by soprano member Carrie Jones to sing and play the piano. The group was tutored by gospel singer, musician, and composer James Cleveland through their manager Thomas Wright. They performed in various churches all over the Detroit area, including New Bethel Baptist Church, Aretha Franklin Father's Church, and Prayer Tabernacle, James Cleveland's church. The Christianaires soon muted into the Wright Specials, named after their manager, Thomas Wright. Kim departed from the group because of exhaustion, and less earnings from their travels totaled only at $9, but was asked by Thomas Wright as a favor to return back to the group because he had secured a deal with Motown's gospel sublabel, Definity. Kim reluctantly rejoined to help record two singles issued from the imprint. That's What He Is to Me, back with Pilgrim of Sorrow, released in July of 1962. And 99 and a half won't do, back with I Won't Go Back, released in June of 1963. After the singles were unsuccessful, Kim did not want to continue singing. A friend of hers named Jean, who saw her sing in church and direct the choir, asked her if she was interested in doing demo work for a friend of his named Johnny Thornton, who was the cousin of Motown songwriters Brian and Eddie Holland. Weston recorded the demos, but the Holland brothers, who were present at the session, did not like the song. Nor did Kim, but loved her voice and asked her if she was interested in signing with them. She agreed and inked the deal with Motown Records in 1961. The first 2 weeks, Kim was constantly sitting in the Hitsville lobby without notice. Frustrated, she walked to the receptionist and said, "You can tell them they can take this contract and shove it." Motown's AR man, Mickey Stevenson, heard her and took her into Studio A, where he had a writer waiting. The writer and Stevenson got into a heated discussion about a few changes in the song that Mickey wanted to make. The writer walked out, and Stevenson took his song, becoming the first tune Kim recorded entitled Love Me All the Way. Love Me All the Way, back with It Should Have Been Me, co-composed by Norman Whitfield, his first composed song at Motown, and Mickey Stevenson, charting number 24 R&B on August 3rd of 1963. Ooh-wee, you got Its flip side, It Should Have Been Me, was later a hit for Gladys Knight and the Pips, issued on Soul in 1968, and Yvonne Fair on Motown in 1974. By this time, Kim Weston and Mickey Stevenson started dating and became romantically linked arm in arm. On Thursday, October 24th, 1963, Tamla issued Just Loving You, co-composed by Kim Weston, but never received credit, back with Another Train Coming on Kim, but without much success.
The moment that I speak, ooh, just love you. There's another train coming down that same old track.
Smokey Robinson began composing music for Kim Weston, and between the two, the working relationship was excellent. Robinson and Ronnie White, a member of the Miracles, composed an issue Looking for the Right Guy, back with Feel All Right Tonight, on Friday, August 7, 1964.
I'm just a plain ordinary girl, looking for the right guy.
Smokey began working with Kim after the departure of Mary Wells from the company in 1964.
I'm just a plain
Looking for the Right Guy a virtue note-for-note rewrite of Wells' mega hit, My Guy.
And I could spend my whole life long looking for the right guy.
Kim Weston joined Billy Eckstine's show with the Four Tops, who were traveling with him, and recommended her to Eckstine. At the time, Weston was sharing a bill with Marvin Gaye in a local club in Detroit. Billy came to see her perform and loved her, and asked her to join his show. They ended up at the Thunderbird Club in Las Vegas. The crowd didn't want to hear any of her Motown songs, so she sang Broadway standard tunes instead. Weston also worked with Harry Belafonte.
I'm just a plain ordinary girl, looking for the right guy.
Mickey Stevenson turned up one afternoon and told Kim they were going to get married, and then whisked her off to a little chapel nearby without any guests. Nobody knew. After exchanging vows, Stevenson then took Weston back to the club so she could play her set while he went back to Detroit. Kim said that Mickey was worried for losing her to a rich guy. They were married on Sunday, April 19th, 1964. After Mary Wells left Motown to side with 20th Century Fox, Marvin Gaye needed a replacement for Wells. Kim Weston had developed a wonderful brother relationship with Gaye during their tour travels together. Kim met Marvin the minute he got off the bus after returning from a Motown review show in Detroit. Husband Mickey Stevenson had the brainstorm idea of teaming Kim and Marvin as a duet. The pair recorded a bluesy tune, co-written by Stevenson, left over from the Mary Wells sessions, called What Good Am I Without You, back with the beautiful romantic harmonizer I Want You Around, co-written by Smokey Robinson and Mickey Stevenson. The song hit number 28 on Cashbox Top 50 R&B Locations chart on October 31st of 1964.
What good, baby, am I? Cause I want you around, I want you around.
Plans were made for an album entitled Side by Side. One side Marvin Gaye and Mary Wells tracks, the other with Gaye and Weston tracks, but it was later scrapped by the company. Promotional still shot photos were also taken to promote the album.
Cause I want I want you around.
Kim was asked to participate in a 1964 promotional 45 single called Greetings to Tamla Motown Appreciation Society. The single was recorded for the few clubs in Europe as a promo for the Motown Act's first 1964 European tour. Each of the acts gives individual greetings over their latest recordings. Here now is Kim Weston's greeting to the fans in the UK.
Hi there, this is Kim Weston. I would like to say hello to all the Tamla Motown fans. And I would like to also say that I'm glad that you enjoyed Love Me All the Way. And I hope very soon that I will be over there to see you. Dave has been very wonderful to everybody, and we have enjoyed him since he has been over here. And I'm sure that we will enjoy everyone else. Bye.
That same year, Mickey Stevenson produced another solo release for Weston with A Little More Love, back with Go Ahead and Laugh. Issued in November 64, it is then withdrawn and re-recorded, but never released.
Cause you see, I'm just a little more love. A little more love. Make me know your mind. Go ahead and laugh. But you only hurt someone who really loves you.
The original pressing of the song remained released in the UK. And towards the end of the month, she lip-synced it on the UK TV music show Ready, Steady, Go, sharing the bill with the Isley Brothers, Martha and the Vandellas, Marvin Gaye, and the Beatles. Kim was the first female Motown artist to perform in the United Kingdom. The Motown imprint released Kim's next two uncharted singles, I'm Still Loving You, back with her reissue of Go Ahead and Laugh, her last issue on Tamla in 1964. And a thriller moment. Back with I'll Never See My Love Again in 1965. Her first on Gordy, both Stevenson and Ivy Joe Hunter Productions. Kim Weston then teamed with songwriters Holland, Dozier, and Holland and wrote the up-tempo classic dance hit Take Me In Your Arms and Rock Me A Little While, giving Weston her first top 10 R&B hit. Back with Don't Compare Me To Her.
Don't compare me with her.
Take Me In Your Arms and Rock Me A Little While zoomed to the number 4 position on Billboard's top-selling R&B singles on November 13th of 1965. HDH followed up that smash by overdubbing Kim's vocals on Helpless, a popular LP track by the Four Tops featured on their second album. Back with A Love Like Yours Don't Come Knocking Every Day, originally recorded by Martha and the Vandellas in 1963, and the B-side to their Heatwave hit, Helpless peaked at number 12 R&B on April 16th of 1966. Kim performed Take Me In Your Arms on Hullabaloo, hosted by Petula Clark, along with appearances on Dick Clark's American Bandstand, Swing Time in Detroit, Where the Action Is, another Dick Clark production, and later The Hyde Litt Show in Philadelphia. Sadly, Motown never planned a solo album for Kim. She was being held back by the company. They decided to concentrate on other female singers featured on their roster. Kim Wesner felt that some of Motown's best material were passed on to the other artists because of her husband, Mickey Stevenson, who of course was the company's AR man. He didn't want to show favoritism to Weston because they were married. Kim says she wasn't worried about it because he was making good money at the company. After her hit Take Me in Your Arms, Weston believed that her early Motown recordings were equally just as good as her hit recordings. Kim is more of a ballad singer, and she loved to sing show tunes. She doesn't classify herself in any particular style of music. Kim Wesner also was the first Motown artist to go to New York to study acting in theater under teacher Herbert Berghoff. When Motown founder Berry Gordy Jr. read her resume, he asked her, "Now you'd be expecting to do show tunes?" When Kim replied yes, he quoted to her that this is a record company, and we don't do show tunes. Now you let the past go right out of your mind. The song that got away from Kim Wesner was Dancing in the Street. Composed by husband Mickey Stevenson, Ivy Joe Hunter, and Marvin Gaye, the song highlighted the concept of having a good time in whatever city the listener was located. The idea for the song came to Stevenson from watching people on the streets of Detroit cool off in the summer in water from an open fire hydrant dancing in the water. When the song was conceived, Mickey showed a rough draft of the lyrics to Marvin Gaye as a ballad. Gaye read the original lyrics but visioned it more as danceable. When Gaye, Stevenson, and Hunter collaborated, the trio composed the song with Kim Wesner in mind. But as Wesner said in a 2011 interview with Vernon Clark and SoFaDetroit.com, that the artist who had the prior hit record would get the next great song. Martha the Vandellas had Love Is Like a Heat Wave, which was a big hit, and so everyone was vying for the next record by her. So my husband Mickey took the record that I was doing and gave it to Martha. She sang it line for line, note for note. The next time I heard Dancing in the Street, Martha was singing it on the radio. Back with There He Is at My Door. Dancing in the Street hit number 8 R&B Cashbox on October 3rd, 1964, and number 2 pop on Billboard on October 17th.
Miss Kim Wesner.
Kim went on her first Motown UK tour in November of 1964 with the Earl Van Dyke Quartet. While on a Motown tour in the States, most of the acts did not want to follow Kim on stage afterwards because of her powerful vocals and performances that echo throughout the theater. On Thursday, August 25, 1966, the Tamla imprint released Marvin Gaye and Kim Wesner's duet album, Take Two, but never issued any singles from the LP. By this time, Wesner's husband and Motown songwriter-producer and AR man, Mickey Stevenson, requested an upright position in the company as for his publishing and stock options for his efforts and contributions to Motown, and better promotion for his wife, Kim. Stevenson felt by now he reached that point of pinnacle success there. Kim Wesner also felt the company's disregard towards the advancement of her career and royalty disputes. So, both her and Mickey left Motown Records in December of 1966. When Tamla issued the Take Two album in August, Both Weston and Marvin Gaye recorded the album almost 2 years prior to its release. Motown finally released a single from the album entitled It Takes Two on Monday, December 5th, 1966, composed by Mickey Stevenson and Celia Moy, and recorded on various dates, Saturday, November 27th through December 6th, 1965, and Wednesday, March 2nd, 1966, backed by the Funk Brothers and the Detroit Symphony Orchestra. Back with the beautiful, dreamy symphonic, It's Gotta Be a Miracle.
It's gotta be a miracle, this thing called love. Never, never, never let go, this thing called love. It takes two, baby.
It Takes Two zoomed to the number four position on Billboard's top-selling R&B singles, March 18th of 1967. Kim was shocked when she heard it was a hit because she had just left the company. Weston said in an interview with Diamond Girl in January 2007, posted by Emerald City, that it was just a case of bad timing.
It takes two, baby. It takes two, baby. Me and you. Just take two.
Meanwhile, Mickey Stevenson received a lucrative offer from MGM Records. The label was on its way of closing its doors when they offered him equity, and also if he could make their sub-label, Venture Records, a present in the R&B market. He signed with the label instantly. Kim Weston also inked a deal with MGM after the company offered her $3,000. She never received any royalties from Motown and was impressed right away with their terms. MGM spent time and money on Weston's first solo album entitled, For the First Time, issued in 1967. Kim displayed her vocal styles by choosing material representing pop and jazz tunes of the day, including members of the Count Basie Band, Wade Marcus, Slide Hampton, Larry Wilcox, Melba Liston, and Tad Jones, who she worked with at the Riverboat Club in New York. One of the songs chosen by Kim was Sonny Cher's 1967 hit, The Beat Goes On.
You know the beat goes on. The beat goes on.
Sonny heard her version of the song and loved it, but Cher, on the other hand, didn't and wouldn't even speak to Kim and even walked away from her. On the front cover, Kim was wearing a beautiful green dress, swaying and displaying herself in a model fashion. Tammy Terrell wore the same green dress on the front cover of her duet album with Marvin Gaye, entitled United, released on Wednesday, August 29, 1967. Without proper promotion from the label, For the First Time was a commercial failure. But a find among record collectors all over. Meanwhile, MGM released two uncharted singles on Kim Weston, including I Got What You Need, back with Someone Like You, Friday, April 28th, 1967. That's Groovy, back with Land of Tomorrow, Monday, September 4th, 1967.
Walking through the park on a summer day. Hey, that's Groovy, that's Groovy. And go to the land of tomorrow.
Weston will return back to the top 40 of the R&B charts with Nobody, back with You're Just That Kind of Guy, number 39 R&B on Saturday, February 24th of 1968.
Nobody's gonna tell me you don't love me, babe. Now you're just the kind of guy that
MGM released Kim's third studio album, This Is America, in 1968. Produced by Mickey Stevenson, the LP focused on the theme of patriotism that reflected in the minds of Americans at that time. It's also well known for Weston's masterpiece recording of Lift Every Voice and Sing, later released as a single along with its A-side and album's title track, This Is America, April 1968.
Lift every voice and sing, children that heaven ring.
Lift Every Voice and Sing, referred to as the Black National Anthem, was first written as a poem by writer and civil rights activist James Weldon Johnson as a part of a celebration of Abraham Lincoln's birthday on Sunday, February 12, 1869. It was later set to music by his brother, singer and composer, John Rosamond Johnson, to honor the world-renowned educator and writer Booker T. Washington, who was visiting Stanton High School for African Americans in Jacksonville, Florida, when the poem was recited by 500 school children as a tribute to Abraham Lincoln. The song is basically a prayer of thanksgiving for faithfulness, freedom, and hope, with its imaginary evoking the biblical Exodus from slavery to freedom of the Promised Land. James Weldon Johnson was born on Saturday, June 17, 1871, and died on Sunday, June 26, 1938, at the age of 67. His brother and composer, John Rosamond Johnson, was born on Monday, August 11, 1873, and died on Thursday, November 11, 1954, at 81 years of age. Lift Every Voice and Sing was first recorded by the male gospel group, the Manhattan Harmony Four, on Paramount Records in 1923. The song became a staple in African American classrooms across the country from the 1930s till the present. Kim Weston first learned the song as a little girl while she attended Brownstown Elementary School and later chose it for her album, This Is America, released in 1968. MGM issued two more uncharted singles on Kim Weston, including one from the This Is America album, The Impossible Dream, The Quest, from the 1965 Broadway musical Man of La Mancha, back with When Johnny Comes Marching Home, released in May of 1968.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe. When Johnny comes marching home again, hoorah, hoorah.
And Thankful, back with I Will Understand, in September of 1968. With no support and promotion from the company, Kim Weston departed from MGM Records in 1969. That same year, husband Mickey Stevenson began working with singer, songwriter, producer Johnny Nash and made a suggestion to Nash about doing a duet together with his wife Kim. The result was a classic album called Johnny Nash and Kim Weston and Buying Tree, a sub-label of Johnny Nash's JAD imprint. The LP was recorded at Master Recording Studios in Beverly Hills, California in 1969. An uncharted single was released from the album entitled My Time, back with We Try Harder in April 1969, produced by Mickey Stevenson.
We try harder, oh, we both try harder, we try.
By this time, Stevenson founded his own record label called People Records and recorded such acts as Hodges, James & Smith, along with his wife Kim Weston. Buying Tree also issued Changes, back with Both Sides Now on Kim in June of 1969. Kim Weston recorded the 1965 marvelous Tamla classic dance hit, Danger Heartbreak Ahead, co-composed by Mickey Stevenson, Ivy Joe Hunter, and singer great Clarence Paul. Stevenson's People label dissolved around the same time James Brown's label of the same name was founded in 1971, initially distributed by King Records, but was acquired by Polydor on Thursday, July 1st, 1971, when Brown signed with an imprint at the time. Before Mickey's label disbanded, People released Kim's fourth gatefold album entitled Big Brass Four Poster in 1970. Pride One, People's sub-label, released Weston's last charted masterpiece single version of Lift Every Voice and Sing, where it entered and stalled at number 50 R&B on June 30th, 1970.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven.
All the proceeds from the single was donated United Negro College Fund. Around this time, Kim displayed her acting chops on a guest appearance on The Bill Cosby Show as Cosby's girlfriend, Gloria Ruskin. The episode was called The Green-Eyed Monster that aired in March of 1971 on NBC television. Shortly afterwards, Weston traveled to Memphis, Tennessee and inked a deal with Stax Records division label, Vault, through her past connections with the imprint's executive, songwriter, and co-owner, Al Bell, who she met during his 10th of years as a radio disc jockey. Vault released Weston's sixth classic recorded album entitled Kim, Kim, Kim in 1970. The LP issued two uncharted singles. The first was If I Had It My Way, back with Gonna Be All Right.
If I had it my way, ooh, you would come home to me.
Everything is gonna be all right. Oh, yes, it is. It's gonna be all right.
If I had it my way.
The song was also released as a promo single on Meekum Vault, including a mono version on side A and a stereo version on side B, and as a regular single on Meekum, a division of Stax Records, in July 1971. The second single release was Little by Little and Bit by Bit, back with I Wanna Be a Hang-Up to You in January of 1972.
Bye.
Around this time, Kim Weston and Mickey Stevenson separated. Weston devoted much of her time to community projects and art groups. In 1972, the Stax organization arranged a benefit concert to commemorate the 7th anniversary of the 1965 riots in the African American community of Watts, Los Angeles. The concert took place at the Angeles Memorial Coliseum on Sunday, August 20, 1972. The concert performers included all of Stax's prominent artists at the time: the Staple Singers, Carla Thomas, Rufus Thomas, Luther Ingram, the Bar Kays, Albert King, Johnny Taylor, Richard Pryor, Isaac Hayes, Project Soul, who later became the group Confunction in the mid-70s as the backing band for the groups, and Kim Weston. After the Reverend Jesse Jackson delivered his memorable speech of I Am Somebody and It's Nation Time, Jackson then introduced Sister Kim Weston to sing the Black National Anthem, Lift Every Voice, and Sing.
Sister Kim Weston, the Black National Anthem.
Every voice and sing till love and heaven ring.
When she began to perform the song, 1,112,000 people stood up with their fists raised in the air as a symbol of togetherness.
Let our rejoicing rise joyfully.
A few months later, after the festival, Stax released a double LP of the concert's highlights and called it Wattstack, The Living Word. The concert was filmed by David L. Walper's film crew and was made into a film that was titled Wattstack. The film was directed by Mel Stewart and was nominated a Golden Globe Award for Best Documentary Film in 1974. It was released in theaters on Sunday, February 4th, 1973. There were some repercussions in Kim Weston participating and performing in Wattstack because some, believe it or not, thought it was too militant. But she did what she felt she had to do and had no regrets in doing it. Weston did it to tell Black people that we have to stand together as one and as a human race. After her rousing rendition of Lift Every Voice and Sing in the movie Wattstack, Kim Weston gained national attention and graced the front cover of Jet Magazine in the Thursday, January 11, 1973 edition. In June 1974, Enterprise, sub-label of Stax Records, released an uncharted single on Kim entitled Goodness Gracious, back with Beautiful People.
Goodness gracious, oh, I love you, baby. Goodness gracious, oh, I love you, boy.
You don't have to be a star, just that you are.
In 1975, Weston dedicated a tribute song to a hometown in the Motor Town called Detroit. That's My Hometown, on Rakim Records.
Detroit, that's my hometown.
In 1976, Kim recorded and reunited with the Hastings Street Jazz Experience and issued an album called The Detroit Jazz Composers LTD on Midnight Records. Weston was also a DJ on Detroit's WCHB station, playing the classics for 2.5 years, and develop a Good Citizens Award. She also did a stunt at WHND's AM 56 Honey Radio in 1993. It only lasted 2 months because she was getting ready to have a syndicated variety show in Detroit. Kim Weston later became involved in politics and various organizations by working with Detroit's Mayor Coleman Young to design a performance arts program for young people in the city to comprehend the fundamentals of the entertainment business. Afterwards, she relocated to Israel, where she began working with young, aspirating singers. Upon her return back to the States, Weston participated and sang the Star Spangled Banner at the Laker-Knicks game in Los Angeles. In the late 1980s, Kim Weston teamed with British producer and founder of Motor City Nightmare imprints, Ian Levine. Weston was the first artist to sign with the label and convinced Levine to sign the other Motown acts as well. Into Motor City's sub, Nightmare, the label released 3 singles on Kim, including Signal Your Intentions in 1987. A remake of a 1965 hit, Helpless, back with Signal Your Intentions. Who's Gonna Have the Last Laugh? Both of these singles, by the way, were issued in 1988. And a white label promo single, You Hit Right Where It Hurts, back with Share a Little Love With Me Somebody by the Monitors in 1997. Right where it hurt me. An album entitled Investigate followed, and she teamed with Marvin Gaye's brother Frankie to make some duets. Among them was a remake of a 1967 classic hit with Marvin, It Takes Two. A follow-up LP, Talkin' Loud, saw a limited release in Europe in 1992. Some of the songs were included on the 1996 compilation, The Very Best of Kim Weston. She was also in the process of suing Motown Records for back royalties. Weston also appeared on Geraldo's talk show in 1990 called The Women of Motown. In 1999, Kim Weston was a recipient for a Pioneer Award from the R&B Foundation. That same year, Weston was involved in a serious car pedestrian accident while walking across the street. Upon hearing two cars collide, Kim tried to get back to the curb, but made it too late as one of the cars hit her, where she thrusted 15 to 20 feet in the air and landed back on her feet. Kim went to the hospital for 4 hours, but through the grace of God, did not have to stay. Till this day, she still feels pain from some of the injuries. Kim returned back to work on an album with Motown songwriter Sylvia Moy, and occasionally toured the US and the UK with her former Motown colleagues, Mary Wilson, Martha Reeves, and Brenda Holloway. In the millennium, Kim was inducted into the inaugural class of the official R&B Music Hall of Fame at Cleveland State University in August 2013. On Friday, October 25th, 2019, Kim Weston performed at the Motown Agogo event at Burt's Warehouse in Detroit. Kim Weston, one of the great leading ladies of Motown, had one of the most unique, distinctive, versatile voices of our generation. Her sultry vocals penetrating the eargasm among the hearts of true music fans, creating an everlasting legacy that will be celebrated continuously. Let's just be thankful that the music outlives the woman. Sunrise or sunset. Until we meet again, musically soul fans, I am the Chancellor of Soul.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven.
Soul Facts, a show written, created, produced, and copywritten by the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone. Soul Facts is a nonprofit music presentation.